Fritz, turn to ban. Ten seconds remaining.
Qualifiers Team Secret facing off against Na'Vi. That's right. Happening again. Another best of three between teams. But this time around, stake. These two teams will face each other in nation. One of these teams is going to be heading to the playoffs. The other team knocked out of the qualifiers. So, get into it. Secret versus Na'Vi. Parker, we already saw Secret losing up against Na'Vi, especially that rather humorous game three where we saw the exact same draft from Team Secret and Na'Vi, almost the same.
Na'Vi's turn to pick. Yeah, and I think that's where, even though Secret maybe on paper should be favorites, Na'Vi seem to match up well against Secret. They seem to throw them off often in the early to mid-game. And I think Na'Vi, some of their drafts are really good. They just had these really good mid-game spikes around some of their Blink Dagger timings. They had like really good heroes for Dendi, one game on the Tinker, another like, successful game on the TA. So we're going to be looking towards something fairly similar. This time around, Na'Vi get themselves the Slaughter, so making sure they have that reliable initiate and taking it away from Team Secret.
What they're going to pick up here. There's plenty of those saving support heroes left. Do they want to pick up anything alongside a Shadow Demon, Dazzle, or Vengeful Spirit? That seems to be, right now, any one of those three supports is usually going to be picked up by teams. It feels like saving hero is pretty good right now because of team fight orientation, but there also seems like, I don't know how you feel about it, Gods, but it seems like there is also a greater push towards late game. I feel like we're not seeing the same kind of five-man death ball strats, like the five-man, like we just clash into each other over and over. I feel like we've progressed a little bit past that.
It does feel like it's become a bit more nuanced rather than, yeah, like you say, brainless, get a mech, five-man push down lanes, SC Luna's kind of fallen off, and I definitely agree that's become more late-game oriented. I think teams have adjusted a lot more to the patch and have gotten better at dealing with that, or just remembered how they used to deal with it, because it hasn't necessarily changed too much. The general principle is still the same, so the Venture Secret, something flexible. More often than not, it is in the support role for them, but it has been played, I think, at least once back, going back to their first best of three by MP as well.
The Slaughter versus Weaver. It keeps on happening. Every single time. Yes. The Slaughter first pick, then Weaver gets ends up being on the other side in some ways because it is a versatile pickup, just like Slaughter, offlane support, or safe lane carry, all available to that hero. But then I think also synergy-wise, Slaughter Weaver is a very dangerous duo. So, one support apiece and one question mark with the Rubick now.
Yep, so slight differentiation with Na'Vi having the first pick. Interesting, Na'Vi on the Radiant side too. A lot of the last series they played, it was always like Na'Vi on the Dire, Secret, often with the first pick. So it does feel like there's already been some slight changes in the way the draft work. And it was actually Puppy who had selection choosing Dire at the start of this game. So giving Na'Vi Radiant side and first pick, but we'll see what Team Secret look to do now with this more physical damage oriented draft of theirs. They're going to have the draw ranger denied from them, so a little bit worried about what might be coming their way. And the PA ban is one of those things, like you ban PA, it's like, all right, I wonder what they might be looking for with a PA ban. And well, draw ranger, one of the better heroes, one of the worst heroes to have against the PA.
Gods, have you unlocked the secret as to the mysterious dire side picks that some of the higher teams have been, because Radiant was very, very preferred at ESL 1 Genting. Everyone was shooting Radiant until the finals, where Newbie and DC, or before that, Newbie was the only team choosing Dire, and the DC also did that. Now, I've seen a few more teams picking that up as well. Have you unlocked any of that mystery?
Not really. I mean, I haven't talked to any of the teams, so I guess it's speculation, I guess. I think that Direcide Shrine placement is much better for their offlane than the Radiant offlane one. It's really easy just to do that Dire offlane, throw your spells, shrine up, and then keep fighting. Roshan, I think, is like fairly neutral, maybe slightly Dire favored. I don't think it's a major difference. Like, Radiant has that really nice high ground where that cliff is, but similarly, that cliff can work to Dire's advantage if they can get control of that area. So, I'm not totally sure, to be honest.
If it works out here for Team Secret, they ban away PA and Assassin. Chen is going to be a notable ban by Na'Vi. Can't let that fall into the hands of Pokey again. That micro in, what was it, Game 2, I think? That was real strong. Oh, that wasn't Game 2. They have the same exact job.
That was against a different opponent, right? That was the following Ad Finem series, I believe. So we'll see what Secret look to get. Mid one heroes are probably like the big thing you're going to be looking at with Secret. He's been their big playmaker for the most part, had a really sick Invoker game. His Sniper game, he was like 21-0 on as well. So Ogre picked up. Well, that kind of lead some credence towards that Sniper pick, or at least something similar. But
If it's not SF or it's not Sniper, I feel like you would. First spirit pickup for Team Secret is a better roaming power, but the Ogre Magi has a lot more static laning phase and obviously great synergy with potential mid one cores.
Reserve time. Yeah, anytime I see an Ogre nowadays, like the first hero that comes to mind is like, oh, they're picking Sniper. Dabby pick a Quap so they get their mid laner, something that's actually a good gap closer against the Sniper and can look to have a good laning stage there. Not to say for sure going to be that Sniper, but it is. Definitely a high possibility and something that Na'Vi will similarly be thinking the same when they see the Ogre pick. 10 seconds remaining.
Kind of interesting that Na'Vi do pick up that their mid laner, even though they have an idea of what could be coming. Reserve time. It's kind of surprising me that they don't actually just wait it out, but apparently they want to be able to hold on to that slot. Or just yet. And I think part of that is the fact that Secret, if you look at their lineup, ooh, Hawk. Well, that's definitely a switcheroo.
Well, they go for the matchup advantage mid lane. Well, not really advantage, but a better matchup than perhaps the Sniper would have had against the Queen of Pain, one of the kind of classic 1v1s, the Puck versus Quap. Now Na'Vi will have to either reveal kind of what the starter is doing or pick their carry. At this point, you can kind of pick Pikettes here if you want. You're not too worried. Secret have that overall last pick. And the nice thing about the Puck is it is still flexible. It could still be an offlaner. Even without the Drow, it is a possibility. So if they see something they want as a last pick for mid one, that could come out as like an overall 10th pick. But it feels like Secret are lacking somewhat in initiation right now. So I'm not. Well, I guess the Puck as an offlaner can work okay as an initiator. It's more about when you get that Blink Dagger timing. So. Not sure how I feel about like an offline Puck if they get some kind of snowballing mid with Kezu potentially getting shut down by Na'Vi.
Yeah, I think I like the idea of the mid Puck here if they're going to be running the offlane Weaver, because we were having that conversation yesterday. With all these offlane Weavers being picked up, they're severely lacking initiation. And if you're going to take your offlane position, which is leading up to this tournament has been divided in pretty much half. It's been either some sort of mech sustain hero that plays pretty fast for you and gets an early mech and you're sustained for team fights, or it's an early Blink Dagger hero and gives you your team fight initiation. But the offlane Weavers have thrown a total wrench in all of that. Does leave some of the lineups lacking sometimes in both in initiation and sustain. So I do kind of like the idea. They pick up the Puck here almost no matter what. Are going to Na'Vi fourth pick Axe.
Yeah, this was their game changing pick in that game 3 and a hero that seems to really suit them in their style. For Na'Vi, I really like seeing them when they have these aggressive initiating heroes. It seems when they're at their best, when both General and RMN can be playing gap closes, like the Axe Slaughter, like having just, most teams will just go for one, like be happy with a Slaughter and then put a Weaver in an offlane or put like a more farming core there. But for Na'Vi, I think having both General and RMN on that role works just fine because Pycat and Dendi are normally playing like these more hard farmers and looking to scale a lot better, so they need those. Having multiple players in that role seems to work better for them.
To be ban away here by Team Secret would have been, I don't know, Juggernaut doesn't feel all too good for me. Against Weaver and Puck, those are two pretty mobile heroes that are usually able to deal with Omnislash pretty well, but it would give them, I would give Na'Vi, I guess, a pretty decent pushing power off that. The healing ward, and it would just get, in general, give them really good mid-game.
Yeah. So, Darkseer ban and Ursa pick. Okay. That's a very different approach than the Jug. I mean, there is some, they both have that single target kill potential, but Jug is more that, like, well-rounded, can push, can provide some heal for his team, have some sustain. Ursa is all in on the aggression for now.
Don't they both have that same problem with very mobile Wars, though? The Weaver and Puck, and now Medusa.
Yeah.
Whoa.
I feel like Ursa is a pick that surprises me, because normally, more often than not, Ursa's being picked up because he counters an enemy hero. Like, you're not just seeing Ursa picked up for the sake of having an Ursa on your team, for having an aggressive core. You're seeing it because there's, like, a Timbersaw on the other team, or you can have a laning matchup mid where he's against, like, an Alchemist or something. Just casually picking an Ursa is a bit unexpected in my mind.
Medusa is gonna be a weird one. So it's off lane Weaver and then do we play
mid Medusa
eventual spirit at that point?
Oh, support Weaver. So Puppy's playing Weaver. Yeah, mid one is gonna be, I think the Medusa wants to be mid lane because that's where you can get the most XP, match up pretty well against the Queen of Pain. You've got the Bloodlust, so I think Medusa mid is the one thing I feel like needs to happen. And then, yeah, they put the Venge onto MP, so that was what we saw, like, back going back to the start of these qualifiers. And I like the Medusa pick a lot, like, against the Ursa. It means I don't think Ursa's going to be able to do a whole lot. There's two big initiators in the Slaughter and the Axe, and it means that Medusa's just a core that's not going to instantly die if you get Blink Crushed or Blink Cold.
Yeah, it's funny. We were talking about how Ogre has this synergy with these other mids. You know, the Sniper, that's a nice one as well. But like these kind of ranged physical DPS, kind of squishy. All those heroes sync up really well with Bloodlust. And the Sniper in particular, because his damage is a little bit weak, and he's also very reliant on attack speed shot early on. Medusa is a hero that is very infamous for having very poor damage for a really long time. So the fact that they were able to set all this whole entire strategy up with both Ogre as well as the core Vengeful Spirit, I really like the way that Seek pulled this whole entire draft together, and it does feel like there's a lot more credibility to a Medusa when you got these two kind of damage.
Yeah, absolutely. I'm still got question marks in my head about the Ursa pick and what it's intending to do this game. Even before the Medusa pick, I was like, well, Ursa's not great against Puck or Weaver. I mean, I guess the Weaver's going to be a support, so that's one thing slightly going his way. But even a core Venge, I don't think of Ursa like, oh yeah, that's the kind of core you want against a Venge. So, I mean, Na'Vi just have to have this idea that they can beat Secret by winning the lanes and like snowballing and getting Roche control. That to me is like all, that's what this Ursa pick says, because it does not work in this game as like a counter to Secret, so it must be something that Na'Vi think suits their style.
So Na'Vi just kind of focusing on their own drafts and their own kind of play style against Secret. Yep. Secret definitely going to be playing the longer game here with the Medusa for sure. poor River, look at this guy. He just, Puppy's been on his ass this whole entire time. Now General is going to be receiving a face full of flaming garbage. Ogre Magi, Ignite does a decent amount. Damage, they're actually just gonna go back and activate a base shrine since both at half HP and TP out. But it is going to be an aggro tri lane coming out from Secret. Na'Vi are dodging it. They've already put Pycat up at the top lane against Kezu.
Dendi mid taking early harass, so this is annoying for him. Means he's gone into level one blink, doesn't have that Shadow Strike harass, so already you can see how this mid matchup is not gonna be all too favorable for Dendi. And this laning setup looking fairly good for Team Secret. Like, they've set up so that bottom lane is really hard to lane in against this Ogre Venge. Top lane Puck's gonna get, I mean, there's not really any kill threat onto this puck, at least currently. So all three lanes should be pretty good for Secret.
I love this this aggressive ward that they got down. Not only is it going to be able to scout rotations and not get countered, right? It's going to be able to see some of the support rotations into mid lane and give mid one the heads up that he kind of needs in the early laning. It's going to also give them a little bit of idea of what General's up to as he has been forced into Radiant Jungle since tri lane slash dual lane scenario. It's just tough. An axe, and generally this hero does jungle efficiently.
It looks like Na'Vi didn't see these lanes coming. Like, General has Tengos and he had double Sal, which I think that the items to jungle is still the Iron Talon, so he must have been expecting a 1v1 against the puck down bottom, and then they would just, like, go top with this Ursa Rubik and, like, try and hold their own. Like, they weren't going to win with that aggro lane on Na'Vi's side, but they can at least be annoying. Pilot Eyes come in, though, and he's messing with General, so...
He took one of the small centaurs, too,
yeah.
And now he's going to be taking half the experience of the big... Rubik's gonna have to pull double duty here, help out General as well as Dendi, but it's an ogre. Not much you can really do against this hero. Oh, naturally tanky. I got getting a couple right clicks here onto Kezu in the top lane, but as you said, there really shouldn't be much kill potential. They're even gonna have Puppy here pulling in, so actually going to make this lane even harder for Pycat to work around.
Yeah, the good news for Na'Vi is they're getting a little bit more out of the map since they have a pseudo jungler and RMM was sitting bottom getting XP, getting a couple CS, so they are getting a little bit extra in terms of overall farm, but the lanes being lost doesn't feel like it's overall worth it. With that said, mid lane is currently going a little bit better. Dendi getting the help from the Rubik has helped harass mid one down fairly low here, so.
Alright, Pycat picked up a haste rune. Death to Pylai die. Oh man, I like that pickup, right. Man. They're just like, nah, screw Pi. Screw his shenanigans in the jungle.
Yeah.
He's messing everything up. He's being a constant threat to General. Let's use this haste rune to kick him the hell out.
Did he TP in with the haste rune, like from top, or was he just already rotating bottom?
He TP'd in. He TP'd into the shrine.
Okay. Well, that's a useful play. I think they were planning on rotating Pi down bottom anyways, or Pika, that is.
Yeah.
Given the laning step, I don't think it was all too favorable for Na'Vi. They want this Axe versus Puck matchup. Puck doesn't really threaten the Axe all too much. It does a little bit more now because Puck has a level advantage, but this is the laning step Na'Vi were hoping for with their initial move out. Now they've actually got it. They are a little bit behind, though, in terms of overall levels and farm.
Like this Puppy, if he comes back to this aggro tri lane, I'm pretty sure they still easily outlane this scenario for Na'Vi. They try and get a pull off, nice wave of terror out there from MP to actually pull creeps right back to him. So they continue a very nice creep equilibrium that forces Na'Vi forward. Very much potential danger, potential spirit, and early leaning presence. That's one of the things that I love the core eventual spirit here is because it. So nice and aggressive and powerful early on that it really does cover some of them.
Yeah, and this is a bench that's happy to be in a 3v3 lane. Has the early levels, has boot wand, now a Bassy ring. Like, this is a perfect setup for MP to be in a 3v3 type lane. So I definitely agree. If Puppy wants to come back down bottom, it is a lane that Secret will have the edge in. It's just whether or not they feel... And I think that's what Na'Vi kind of want. They want General to have a straight 1v1 if possible. They want... Queen of Pain, Dendi to be somewhat uncontested in his 1v1. And so far, he doesn't seem to be too clear where he wants to go. He is lurking around this bottom lane, so it does seem like he is going to make a play down here.
On a Pycat here, double stuns already up. Pycat is going to slow down some of his pursuers here with a clap, but they need a little bit more damage. Unfortunately, the bugs did not latch on Pycat. He will manage to get away, but still, they force him back. Healing cells and clarities to be... He also had magic. Definitely good.
Yeah. Puppy waited for that double stun initiation, just couldn't quite close the gap fast enough. And Na'Vi with Pycat healing up with the clarity, they could look to try and turn around some of this aggression, but similarly, Pilot Eye, he's got mana coming his way. It looks like Puppy's just going to wander off, get some wards down, and see what else he can get done around this bottom lane. Looking for a courier, perhaps?
Yeah, he was. He spotted out the courier because of aggressive ward. Navi, similarly, they spotted Puppy heading towards the courier and pulled evasive maneuver. Couldn't be found here. Man, everywhere I look, it's just like Navi losing. You know, their tri-lane is like hiding underneath the tower. Dendi's forced to play back because this sick snake has now gotten very dangerous and it keeps on backing to him over and over again. Out of his mana. And the general is playing jungle half the time. That's really the one bright light.
Yeah.
Navi roster play cat maybe going on here. Stunned up. MP is going to be able to get close enough. Telekinesis actually pushes him back. They now have a stun. They're going to try and finish off Pylai Dai. Now, Pycat is probably giving up his life for this one, but at least they do get the kill. Now, the orb in from the puck. Kezu will stop Bivver's TP out with the coil and make that a 2-for-1.
All right. I mean, Pycat making sure he gets the kill before he goes down, and the pup TP and only secures a Rubick. I feel like that's not quite worth Kezu's rotation because he was actually having a really good time against this Axe up top. Axe was being pushed back in the jungle. Because Kezu had that early treads, it was a pretty tough lane for him. So Kezu wants to get more out of this movement, and he is now swinging through mid lane to see what he can do to Dendi.
Dendi's just always out of mana. Snakes are just going straight for him, and even the infused raindrop is not enough to be able to win this game of harassment.
Really feels like Pycat, there's just no good lane for him. He TP's top as soon as he respawns. Like, alright, there's a tri-lane bottom and Puck's TP'd in. This top lane looks like a good place to get some farm and levels, but again, he's just slowly... He's taking a long time to come online, and Ursa, being a snowball hero, you don't want to see him have a bad laning stage, and that's exactly what's happening right now for Pycat.
He down at bottom. Dendi, this is where he's going to pick up his level 6, apparently. He's going to be leaving Minwan alone at the mid lane and collecting some of this. I guess Dendi, being the most mobile hero, is probably the best to go against aggro tri-lane that was running. Of course, now the supports are kind of all over the place. Puppy sitting in the Radiant jungle near mid. Pylai Dai on fire side also approaching that mid lane. Want to make sure that Minwan is safe with some of these heroes off map.
It feels like a lot of lane swapping that doesn't necessarily advance Navi. Kezu caught out at top, but he's gone.
They needed that instant crush while the telekinesis pullback was still happening, and they managed to get the call, and there was not the right kind of coordination from Navi to claim it like that.
Puppy's able to stop Dendi getting the bounty rune and force him back to base. Everything coming up Team Secret right now. And normally you think like, okay, they're swapping their lanes, they want to turn them into more like advantageous lanes, but they're going from like really bad lanes to still pretty bad lanes. They will snipe the courier with this smoke rotation.
Don't gaze, is it going to be able to go off fast enough? It is! Pylai Dai will be saved by that ultimate. And the rest of Navi can't actually chase him down, but a courier was definitely a great pickup. If that whole entire rotation, that could have just happened, that smoke rotation by Navi, and they could have just failed to pick up anything.
Yeah. The courier is the bigger kill than the ogre anyways, as far as income goes for your team. Does come at the cost. MP getting tons of space in this bottom lane, takes an early tower. Feels like MP and Kezu just have all the room in the world to just do whatever they want this game. If they want to TP and rotate, they can get kills for their team. But alternatively, they're probably like telling their team, like, look, if you guys can just hold your own in your lanes, I'm going to get this tower, or I'm just free farming away. Kezu can get a fast blink dagger and probably be like level 9, level 10 potentially, and have a lot of really strong rotation potential. So this laning setup is looking really good for Secret right now. They're going to hit a very strong mid-game spike here based on how much they've won this early game.
A top 3 CS on Team Secret and are occupying the top 3 most of the time. Bots, Buck, and Medusa pretty much neck and neck with the Ursa, but it's Eventual Spirit who's pulling way out ahead. MP has been free farming for days. Eventual Spirit is going to be a very dangerous threat going into the mid-game with all this.
Yep, just a short bit of gold away from that Helm of the Dominator, and then things get very problematic with that extra that he can help protect himself with or play aggressive with, so mid lane Dendi. Yeah, they can go a mid one here, but that is not particularly close. I mean, the TP in, if there wasn't an ogre behind mid one, may have been potential threat, but I think for Navi, you're just really eyeing off this Axe Blink Dagger. He's rushing it. I think Navi recognized, I think he was going to go this build regardless whether the lanes went poorly or not, but he is going to be the key like game changer for them. When they get this Blink Dagger up, they need to start making rotations to kill core heroes. Like, this Venge is getting away with way too much down bottom. Same for Puck up top. You need the Queen of Pain and Axe to team up, go for a smoke rotation immediately upon picking up Blink.
Yeah, big part of it is just the secret cores, right? You can't fight into this Vengeful Spirit early on, and then the Puck they didn't have any kill power against, so everything's banked on this Blink Dagger of General and see if he can make the right kind of initiates to turn this thing. Now, Bidwan, oh man, he was kind of low mana, but then he got a pretty decent mistake, and now they're going to make their initiation onto multiple heroes, try and pull out Midwan before he gets off the mana shield, and they do get him. Now a second one, Pylai Dai also goes down, Puppy got to receive the shop from General here. Kezu comes in and does manage to get a turnaround kill. MP and Kezu dueling up here against three. RMN misses out on the crush, and they will not pursue into secret. More than happy with a 1-for-3 exchange. We said this Blink Dagger is everything to Na'Vi, and General did accomplish just that.
Yeah, it was. I think Secret themselves were in a strong position around that mid tower. They had Venge invised up. Level 9 Venge, very scary at this stage because of how farmed she is. Similarly, the Puck Blink Dagger had been picked up as well. Secret themselves were at a power spike there. The difference is, it's Na'Vi who get the initiation. Whoever jumps first there is going to win that fight. If Venge is able to get a stun out of the invis to burst down the Queen of Pain, that Axe Blink Dagger doesn't achieve what it does there, because there's no Queen of Pain Sonic Wave, there's no Scream, but it's Na'Vi who take the initiative, get the jump, and Secret were just kind of sitting around. You can't really bait against the Blink Dagger because you're going to lose that Medusa before anything can happen. And perhaps if Venge was in position to swap Medusa out, it could have been different, but that Medusa dropped so fast.
I mean, what about something as simple as him having mana shield up?
That could have made a big difference. Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, he was hitting tower. He could have just had the mana shield up and been good, but didn't expect that instant initiation. Now, Secret have made a smoke rotation in. They got a successful scan, but what they don't expect is Na'Vi are so grouped up here, may still win it anyway. The enrage goes off from Pycat, but he's kind of stuck inside the trees with a bog on top of him, too. Now, coiled up, all of that is going to be bringing little Pycat down. So they managed to get that one. Mid one is going to be the target of a rotation of General once again, but this time with the mana shield up, it seems unlikely they'll be able to kill.
Yeah, mana was perhaps oversight from mid one last time, not having it online. There's not really any reason that he doesn't need to save his mana for an ulti Mystic Snake. He had more than enough mana for mana shield and to use one of those spells, so as it stands, it's some space for Iron Man. He's going to just watch Pycat go down while he gets some farm towards his Blink Dagger up top. We'll see if Na'Vi, probably waiting that Sonic Wave cooldown, look to make another aggressive maneuver now. General has Blink Dagger. He's just going to camp around this top lane, and this is actually looking like a potential tier 1 tower. And yeah, with Dendi and Bibba's rotations up here, this is pretty much an impossible position to defend. Pycat, though, is in no man's land. You should not be down here when you've got four teammates pushing up top, and the enemy's missing from the map. So yeah, he needs to vacate this bottom lane while his team takes off.
That's the bad part about these Medusa lineups when you're facing them. It's not like it's a clear push that you have to defend. It's always present, right? That chip damage is always there. So even though Na'Vi are hitting these, they're beginning to hit some of these timings for the mid game, they're still losing these towers just by simple small rotations. Nice initiation from General. A two-man call leading to the Sonic Wave. Mid one will survive through it initially, but doesn't have enough mana for the Stone Gaze, so he can't actually repel Na'Vi. Na'Vi get the opportunity to just run over whatever heroes they can. They've already picked up two bolt cores from Secret. Now they're looking for a support as well. Puppy is dusted up. They're going to be able to get the Corrosive Haze and the call, so Puppy doesn't have a chance for a time-lapse there. Three down on the side of Secret. Another big turnaround here from Na'Vi. The execution just seems to be their favor, as every single one of these fights is about a 1,500 to 2,000 gold exchange.
Yeah, I mean, there's good reason why Na'Vi, through all their struggles with some of their past rosters, everyone was always hyping up General. And everyone, whenever you talk about Na'Vi going into a series, you're like, they got to play around General. This is the guy who can win them games. This is the one player of Na'Vi who is like the X factor, similar to like maybe what DJ was for Fnatic. This guy has been phenomenal. And these two initiations he's had, the timings when he's gone for them have been perfect. Hitting both the Venge and the Medusa there in that Blink call was crucial. Perhaps a bit of a misplay by Secret by positioning them such that could happen, but still fantastic from General. He will go down in mid lane though. Not so fantastic. We cursed him a little bit there, but all in all, like Na'Vi, these team fights are exactly what they need. They time it. They get an Aegis off of that successful fight at bottom while Secret are kept busy, and suddenly they've got two good team fights in a row. Pycat's got some decent farm. He's now going to have a Blink Dagger soon. and Na'Vi can look to take another fight once they've got Sonic Wave back up again.
They get caught trying to be aggressive, trying to create space for that that Aegis. General does go down, but well worth it. Level 12 Ursa with an Aegis. Pink Dagger coming in and a Helmet Dominator. Got initiation across the board now, and Secret are probably going to have to play a lot more grouped up, which means they're not going to... The first 10 minutes of this game, it was a very nice static laning phase where everyone was split apart and all their lanes were good, but now they're very rapidly going to see, I lie die here, that with all these Blink Daggers coming in, Secret don't really stand a chance if they split apart. They're going to have to group up more, and that's just going to mean... I think Vengeful Spirit's farm is going to slow down it because Medusa is probably going to be the primary farm.
I mean, Venge was top of the net worth by a good 1,000 gold at one point, but that has quickly ceased to be the case here as Na'Vi going the aggressive with a smoke and Kezu.
Attempted crush. Kezu's phase shift is level 2, so lasted just long enough, but he doesn't manage to get away
from that
intense physical damage thanks to Corrosive Haze.
Yeah, this is Na'Vi just picking them off one by one, and this is, I think a lot goes back to the draft and the Na'Vi playstyle. They'll put RMN and General both on playmakers. They like to have these like dual initiators, not just be relying on one person. And Secret themselves only have Kezu for that role. And Puck is just not really that reliable as of an initiator compared to a Slider or an Axe. You get an instant pickup with the Slider, the Axe. The Puck, you blink, you Dream Call. There's possibility of a counterplay because that hero is not stunned for all too long.
I love that. The way that Na'Vi set that up, right? They go for this initiation without a smoke. They just straight up run into the lane while it was dark and blink in with this fresh Blink Dagger, a Pycat, get a quick kill. And then they show a couple of heroes, but they still smoke up and they still move aggressively, something that Secret very clearly were unprepared for as they're just trying to figure, hey, Na'Vi, they picked off one. They're probably going to go for a top lane push and we're just going to farm our jungle in the meantime. But that extra bit of aggression from Na'Vi that is very rapidly becoming this new squad signature style does catch Secret off guard and does result in a core kill or pressure onto this mid tower, which they desperately need to take, right? This is one of the keys to unlocking some of the dire jungle that are benefiting from.
Yeah, absolutely. And we'll see if Na'Vi want to make a kind of aggressive play around this mid lane. MP very tanky. 1800 HP! At 18 minutes in, holy crap, that is unbelievable. Venge, what a hero. This is why you play the Venge as a core.
And you've got a lot of armor to back that up too, because you are an agility hero, so. Ben, they do have some very aggressive wards, so I believe some of this has been scouted. RMN doesn't actually see Pylai die, they kind of walk past each other. RMN will zip away with his sprint, but seeing two bottom, they're going to try and put pressure on mid now with their three heroes. EP rotations. Silence. You have to be a little bit careful here. There is an opportunity for an instant stun if they get a coil and swamp at the same time. Pykai could be in a bad position, but General's there with the recourse. They manage to get a call onto MP, but he's too tanky. Now mid one right in the middle of all this with the stone gaze. Pykai has to turn and fight, but there goes that Aegis, and there goes General too. The initiator's down. RMN's pushed away. That's going to be another form of initiation that's going to be missing for Na'Vi. Fortunately, they do manage to get the Ursa out with a quick blink after the Aegis revive, but it's still a nasty engagement. They really wanted to take that mid lane tower, but Secret denied them that.
Yeah, MP again, his tankiness coming into play there, and mid one showing up at the perfect time with the stone gaze. Really good usage. As soon as Na'Vi engaging you with the Ursa, you've got to pop that, and the result of that is General instantly dies. General's relying on that blink follow-up from the Ursa, the Slaughter, even a Queen of Pain blink in. Na'Vi have four blink gap-closing heroes, and they want to just try and overrun Secret with numbers. Like, when they get that first kill, suddenly there's four heroes on you and there's no counterplay possible. But by instantly stone-gazing, Ursa gets forced back. Even with an Aegis, he can't just let himself get stone-gazed up. There's no point in that. You're not going to get the kill. So Secret able to take out General, and without General alive, that fight gets very, very tricky.
Wonder how many smokes Na'Vi have left. They don't have any in their inventory, but... does kind of feel like they were operating on smoke ganks before, and they got themselves, you know, a few team fights and a few pickoffs that were quite notable, and get some good map control back. But these kind of just more straight face plays, especially because of the fact that Secret has good, strong, like aggressive wards that are able to see a lot of these rotations before even close to Seek. Does seem like the Na'vi rotations are being read by Secret when they're smoked, and as a result being countered.
Yeah, I think the other big thing is both Medusa and Benji at this point, where smoke ganks and rotations aren't just going to kill them. Now with a Manta style and an extra ulti orb, Midwine is very tanky, same for MP. He's getting incredibly tanky himself on the bench. And once Puppy has an Aghanim Scepter, I think the ability to blink in and burst one hero down just gets taken away. And that's where Na'vi's draft perhaps struggles to kind of function in a teamfight setting. They can't really initiate easily on Secret unless they're initiating on Puppy himself.
One of the things is they need some extra damage. Their initiation. General's trying to finish up a blade mail, but it's going to be swapped back here. Secret, but Kezu kind of blinks a little bit too far forward. General does manage to get off the call, survives for a while, but will still end up going down. No extra disables needed. More TP's out. Piver should be able to make it. Oh, Coil just half second late there. Kezu decently fast on the reactions from the bug catch, but not good enough.
Yeah, well, the end of the world for Secret, who was back off, defend some of these lanes. Pika needs to not get caught out here as they get dewarded, but Na'vi looks like we'll just play some efficiency game up top. It will be a Deso as Pika's next major item. Interesting option. Good synergy with all the minus armor from the Slaughter, but not the typical Ursa pickup you'd expect.
I think it's required here in this game because they don't really have a building hitter, right? And they have to close out this game sometime soon because it is so. I think in many ways Pycat doesn't have the other options. He's gotta go for has to go for offensive items for damage, for building hitting. No one else is gonna be able to do it.
Yeah, I totally agree. I think with the fact that Iron Man and General are both playing initiates, there's no damage coming from them. It's only Dendi who has damage output, and if Sonic Wave's on cooldown, like, how do you take a fight? Like, where's your damage coming from? So yeah, the Deso makes total sense. He'll go back for the Aghanim Scepter afterwards, but I think, yeah, this, an item like this almost feels like a necessity for Na'vi to be able to scale, and not even scale to the late game, but just scale into this mid game to be able to kill heroes like Medusa, Venge, and see what Secret can do. This is not looking good for Pycat.
Wow, Pycat. Yeah, the read. Some of the mid lane, maybe he spotted something from the mid lane creeps or something. Does manage to blink away ahead.
Sick reaction from him, and Na'vi will look to trade top lane for mid lane. They may not even lose mid. And if Secret want to stop this tower push from coming, they'll just have to TP back and forego pushing at the moment. And yeah, it looks like that's going to be the call.
Probably for the best. They're about to finish up that Scott. That will be huge. Many of these heroes, they have the initiation, but as we've said, they don't have the damage to pop many of these heroes, and then they'll have a hard time getting out of the fight once that Scotty's up on mid one.
So next Roshan becomes key for both teams, but much more so Na'vi, like, who can't let Secret get the next Aegis and really want it themselves on Ursa. Like, you've got this Desolator build, you're very squishy, your impact in a fight is very volatile. Like, the difference between doing zero damage in a fight or doing the most damage in a fight can just be one stun or having an extra life. So getting Pycat and Aegis becomes a high priority for Na'vi, but it's more about the how, not the if you can get it.
MP's in an awkward position here. He may be caught by these shrine rotations. Pycat's not going to turn around, though. He just keeps on marching forward, goes for Pylai Dai because RMN's the back line. They do also catch MP, but that blade mail is going to do a decent amount of damage. They've caught Pylai Dai, but the stone case is turning them away from MP, who managed to get the swap back. Biver, a free pickoff there. Pycat still trying to lay waste to the back lines there, but is going to be coiled up and now kited around. He will end up going down here to mid one as they turn. RMN also being caught, and Dendi, having very little impact in that team fight, was not able to line up a good Sonic Wave with such a disjointed two-sided fight.
Yeah, it got split up perfectly by that stone gaze. Like, Ursa just ignored the Medusa because he was behind her, so just kept right-clicking the backlines. But that was initially just an Ogre, and then it was Puppy on the Weaver. You're not going to kill a Weaver as an Ursa. You're always going to get kited around. The Shikuchi, the time-lapse, there's zero way to kill Puppy there. And as you kind of mentioned, Dendi not really being able to get himself into that fight, line up a Sonic Wave, meant that initiation was kind of wasted. They couldn't bring down MP, and, well, Secret pick up those next couple of items. The Scotty is there. MP has a Hurricane Pike back at base and is going to go back for a Solar Crest. This is an item that can completely cripple Pycat, so be very, very tough for this Ursa in these upcoming fights, getting kited around, getting solar crested up. I think Na'Vi know. They're smoking up, perhaps hoping... No, they know Roche is up in the next 45 seconds because that's the max respawn time, but it is that max respawn. That's where they will, unfortunately, not be so lucky.
Like, it's going to result in nothing. RMN gets his smoke pop. Now going to be swapped back by MP straight into a stun. Puppy activates the shrine, thinking, if the fight's coming to me, I'll need a little bit of extra HP and mana to work with. And now Na'Vi, with that smoke, thinking they were trying to challenge Roshan, have just given it away, potentially, with 40 seconds left on RMN and only a few seconds left on the Roshan.
Yeah. Nice. That it is definitely more interesting to have that kind of dynamic Roche timer, because it makes it so much harder to plan some of these plays. You kind of got to roll the dice a bit. And if you're behind, you can't just say, all right, we smoked the second Roche's respawn. You don't know when it respawns. So when you're in this disadvantageous position as Na'Vi, you've got to take a risk, and that risk does not pay off there. Roche wasn't up for Pycat. If it was up, he could have just taken Roche while his team just sat around the pit, smoked up, waiting to see if Secret came in and use like your positional advantage, but there was no Roche. Iron Man goes for a too aggressive of a play on the high ground, and they get punished. So game continues to go south for Na'Vi, and that Roche could potentially be taken by Secret. They've got minus armor from Venge as well as Weaver, plenty of damage output to kill it if they want to.
I cat's all in. Got that tier two, I guess.
On TP out now.
Trying to die for his sins. Well, maybe Na'Vi can get another tower off of that. They forced a lot of rotations with that, because they probably thought there's no way Pycat's committing like this without some backup. So now most of the heroes are on the top half of the map, and they're going to try and go for a bottom lane push while Roshan being taken by
Getting a tier 1 or something would be at least nice, but they've lost all map control. All their outer towers, the shrines were starting to fall. It was Na'Vi who are losing their top shrine by Roshan. Before Secret's like, wait a second, let's just TP back and get these kills. But yeah, this is going to be tough. They really want they could defend bottom, but it doesn't look like Medusa has any interest in TPing in. Doesn't even have a TP scroll currently, so we'll just make the long walk towards this bottom lane. Na'Vi Secret not really in any rush right now. Like, their lineup's going to scale fantastically. Like, they're stronger right now, they've got the Aegis and all, but they don't have to try and end this game necessarily. If anything, they're better off just shutting down some of the Na'Vi progression and playing it a bit safer until they're sure they can get that high ground push happening.
Shrine's being out. There's a shrine left now for Radiant Sign. Away from Na'Vi. Na'Vi are looking to be able to catch something because they know the Medusa is bottom, but it just can't quite get there, in fact.
And Medusa's already back now.
Now Medusa TPing onto the shrine. Secret will begin their turn. They're going to get some combo stuns here onto Pycat. RMN's going to interrupt that one. Does manage to get a decent crush, but now caught in a two-man coil. Kezu makes sure that two of them will end up going down. Biver caught next to RMN. So both the supports down from Na'Vi. Now a push will ensue.
Shrine's a pretty big change to the way the Dota 2 has played out now. You've lost both your top towers, you've lost your mid-tier one, yet Medusa is still able to TP back in, not directly in the fight, but very close to the fight, after pushing out the bottom lane, and is in a position to join the team for a high ground push. With both supports dead, Na'Vi trying to get some scraps of farm in the middle and the bottom side of the map. General has 2.7k gold, but at this point may just need buyback for this high ground defense, and I don't even know if Na'Vi can defend this one.
Like, no matter what happens, they're going to be crippled. If they can defend this, they will have lost most of their map control, and it'll be hard to gain that back. General's going to come in with his Shadow Blade, try to go for the back lines here with the Shadow Blade and the Blink Dagger, but they do have the counter vision. He managed to blink away from that one, but now swap back in. His initiation going to be total futile now as he gets right-clicked apart. RMN also going to be caught here. Nice activation of the shrine by Biver, while Pycat goes for some of the side heroes, but can't finish any of them off. There's too many four staffs, too many swaps, too many problems for him to lock down these very mobile heroes. And now Midwan just keeps on marching forward. He's got half the mana, still has Aegis, has that Solar Crest to be able to work off of, and all of Secret is sitting behind him, waiting to go. Another
time lapse
activated by Puppy. On a mid one, healing off a
16 second cooldown. Like, yeah, just to give him like an extra 300 mana. Oof. Puppy time lapses. They lose Kezu though.
That's something. Dendi's gonna keep on moving forward here. They kind of ignore Dendi. Just go ahead and keep on right-clicking down PyCat MP. Make sure he continues to kite that hero puppy. Oh, he gets taken apart there with the enrage activated by PyCat. He does the extra damage necessary. Sonic Wave hits a little bit there. Does manage to finish off MP. PyCat desperately needs to get away, though. It does have a Blink Dagger up. He's good. Now they're turned around. They can actually pursue them out, especially with RMN. They're going to be able to catch Pylai Dai here. Midwan is going to turn and fight as best he can. But I'm not sure if Midwan can, though. He is going to be able to pick up one and is going to be brought down. The problem is, on his second life, he's not going to be receiving any help. Na'Vi are actually going to buy back on RMN just to make sure that Mid 1 can't actually escape. Get the Corrodes of Haze, and PyCat's just waiting and waiting and waiting until he can make his initiation. General almost dies here, but the Shadow Blade activated. Now the Enrage with the damage coming in. Mid 1 pops a Manta. Maybe he can still pick up a couple more kills here. General gets the call. He gets one. Ooh. He was so close to picking up two or three more. He almost 1v4 the rest of Na'Vi.
That was exciting to watch. I'm watching this like, is he actually gonna 1v4? That slider buyback, really good call from RMN. Recognize, all right, this Deuce is about to respawn with Butterfly, full HP, full mana. My Axe can't fight, my Ursa can't fight. I've got to buy back to stop the Deuce TPing out and make sure we get this kill, which will at least salvage this high ground defense into a slightly acceptable and still playable position. But that was some hold from Na'Vi. Like, the fact they're still in this game is a big surprise to me.
Goes to show, first of all, I think we learned from that top lane engagement, that really awkward one where they half ignored NP. And PyCat jumped forward. They can't split their damage up. They have to utilize the small bit of disables that they have and the burst damage of the Earth to focus one hero down. And that's what they did in the winning part of that engagement, right? They blink in, they kill Kezu really quickly.
Yes.
And then they kind of
kite
back.
And you can't even react with a time-lapse. Like, he had time-lapse up. It was just too fast.
Silence onto two. RMN and Dendi going to be caught inside the coil, but now General managed to get a call. If they can continue to lock down Puppy, this would be a big kill, but none of their disables can get there in time. Biver did not have the Blink Dagger up, so Secret will manage to escape. Na'Vi unable to get, they really needed a pickoff so they can maintain some sort of aggressive force. Well, Mid 1 was dead, but that's not going to be the case here, and are losing map.
Yeah. It's a bit of an interesting, go back to the Shadowblade General, interesting little pickoff. I feel like he got really unlucky with that Sentry Ward top lane. Like, yeah, teams are often going to push with a Sentry, but up until that point, Na'Vi had no invis. So that Sentry in lane was purely to scout out, like, a high ground observer ward or something. It's like it wasn't even in a position to scout out the high ground observer ward, which teams often have when they're defending high ground. So I feel like that was a pretty good play of his to pick up a Shadow Blade to try invis into that fight. Secret just happened to be ready for it with a Sentry Ward, despite there being no invis.
General knows he can't just go on the Medusa, right? He's got to get the back line. That's been a problem for most of Na'Vi. It's why these smoke initiations are oftentimes the most successful. Not sure if this one's going to be, though. They're going to go on a Pylai Dai first. Swap back. My MP's right in the middle of all these heroes. So is Midwan, though. He immediately goes and targets General first with all this damage. Good Sonic Wave. The back line's PyCat does manage to kill Pylai Dai. He now focuses on Kezu. Can't quite get him, though. Too mobile. And he's now locked in by the Dream Coil. RMN tries to come in, give him some relief. The Crush comes in a bit too late, though. 70 seconds on the clock. For PyCat, RMN, a similar scenario here. General comes in with the Blade Belt, does manage to finish off MP, and Midwan's running out of mana, but do they have the damage to finish him off? A little bit more of a juke, and they get him. Finally, General does manage to bring him down with the Culling Blade. They're going to pursue for more now with the Shadow Blade and Blink Dagger. Puppy gets spotted out. Shikuchi stolen by Biver, but he is too quick, and it looks like Kezu is going to be able to get away from Dendi as well. Another surprising engagement. The smoke push out by Na'Vi does result in a pretty deep trade-off.
It's one of those things. If Na'Vi can keep buying time, I feel like they've got one last like good peak for their lineup. Like, I don't think they're going to win the like super late game, but if they can get Dendi to level 25, get that spell lifesteal going with an Octarine Core, and the other item I think is the Aghanim Scepter on PyCat's Ursa. If they can get those two things happening, they'll reach another like kind of decent power spike where perhaps they'll be able to fight into Team Secret. If they can keep getting these jumps on the back lines, like ideally the Weaver, the other big hero is the Puck, as you kind of saw in that high ground defense earlier. If you can kill these heroes at the start of the fights with your Slaughter and your Axe initiations, things could start going all right for Na'Vi. They have, as we've seen a couple of times, they can deal with Medusa, they just can't attack her first. She's going to be the last hero you go for. Similarly, MP, I feel like you can't be fighting him at the start of the fight. He's got the Solar Crest, the Hurricane Pike, he's got good mobility. You've got to ignore these two carries. It's very counterintuitive for most lineups. Like, you want to kill the mid or the carry first. Like, these are the problem heroes. But with this secret draft, they're heroes you've just got to ignore because of the time lapse and because of just how much, like, utility these other heroes, like the Weaver and the Puck, offer in these fights.
Yeah, Kezu's going to be even higher priority and even more rewarding to kill because of a Scythe of Ice pickup that he's working towards. Again, any sort of quick initiation, if they could just eliminate all that net worth from him real quickly, that would be mega value. And then, as you said, Puppy, the problem heroes. That Aghanim's time lapse always ready to go. Navi might be able to sneak in a Roshan here, though, before Secret can make the rotation across with the Corrosive Haze. Dezo and just sheer physical damage on Pycat. I blamed that pickup, and this could be a finished up Ags now for Pycat. I'm not sure if saving for buyback with the Aegis is really well.
I think the position they're in is like one of those, like when you're down the racks and you're fighting a lineup that's going to scale better than you and has an advantage, saving for buyback is not something you want to do like as one of the damage deals. Like a Slaughter or an Axe saving for buyback seems fine because they're the ones starting a fight and they're likely going to die when they initiate. So if they can come back and provide like a second round of control, fantastic. General is on cooldown though. RMN is also on cooldown. But those are the two heroes you want to have buyback on. The Co-op, the Ursa, just buy all out if you can. Like you want to make sure you have those big items that will allow you to win a fight.
Maybe the next or general. Big key game-changing items potentially have been picked up by Navi. Need that desperately need that level 25 for Queen of Pain. That would be an upgrade, especially with this cheese. He would have such great survivability and may not be expecting there. Trying to keep top lane pushed out. They're gonna cut the wave while General continues his push. He's TP Mac though, anticipating Secret's push through mid.
Yep. Mid one's got a pretty good level 25 talent himself coming soon with the 25% lifesteal. Some of these fights, I feel like if he had lifesteal in those last like two fights and engagements, I think he would have, I mean, he would have easily won that 1v4. That lifesteal would have made all the difference there. And that last fight, I think, would have also tipped the tide in his favor. So his level 25, it looks like he's farming ancients, he's farming neutrals. He just wants to try and finish that one up.
Smoked
I don't
up.
Think you go for the Stone Gaze stun here. Yeah.
I don't think so. I think most of the time enemy team play around the Stone Gaze enough that you can't ever level that thinking you're able to reliably get.
Yeah, and 1 second, it's not like from 3 to 4 seconds isn't like a game changer necessarily, whereas 25% lifesteal from zero, that's potentially gonna to turn around a fight in your favor, so. We'll see how Secret, they're looking to siege into an Aegis. I mean, that really shows how confident they feel their position is.
Well, those lightning procs are kind of rough. They are going to start going onto the Queen of Pain here, locked in, Scythe of Ice, as well as the Coil. He is going to get a helpful four staff there from Biver, and they activate the Shrine as well. They're taking, receiving so much damage from mid one, and his Dusa with the Bouncing Lightning and all the Split Shot. They're all dropping low here. They need to activate another Shrine, going to throw back another Medusa Illusion into the real one, but it doesn't save Biver's life. He's now down for 50 seconds, and Secret have a numbers advantage. General needs to even this out. He needs to find the right kind of initiation. They're going to start going on to him with Pycat, but Jesus, look at him. He doesn't do anything, and Midwan just rips him apart. Now RMN somehow gets caught in the Stone Gaze. Pycat comes back, but there's Scott enough. They're easily going to be able to kite around this carry, and I think Navi, it's time to say goodnight for game one.
Yeah.
They're down with three heroes. No buyback.
That dude should just, like, walked in, fighting into an Aegis, fighting him with cheese. That was 1v5ing with Bloodlust, with Lotus Orb. You can't touch mid one. You've got to find a way to get the back lines. When he's got all these buffs on him, there is absolutely nothing you can do. The time lapse is sitting behind him, and I feel like Navi, I mean, the vision game and their position was such that mid one was in their face, and they couldn't get past. Really, really well closed up.